folks. It's a little bit more crowded here than we're used to at a normal council meeting. I do appreciate the fact that all of you came out tonight, so thank you very much for that. Tonight we are having a special Sierra Madre City Council meeting with a joint meeting with Pasadena Unified School District. We've got the Superintendent John Gundry here. We've got board members Scott Phelps, Ramon Miramontes, Kim Kenny, Elizabeth, what's your last name? Elizabeth Pomeroy, Ed Honowitz, and we do believe that Renata Cooper is on her way, might be stuck in traffic. We're going to begin anyway, but for those of you who are sitting on this side of the table, we've got Councilmember Chris Kerber, Councilmember John Capocha, Councilmember John Harabedian, Mayor Pro Tem Nancy Walsh, and then myself, Josh Moran. And at this point, I'd like to ask everybody to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Just like we do in school, ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you all very much. We do have a packed house here tonight, and I know that we've got a lot of issues going on with the schools in Sierra Madre themselves. We've got three items up for discussion tonight. One being an update on the construction of the Sierra Madre Middle School. The other being an update regarding the Measure TT bond funds and just where those stand. And lastly, which just concerns Sierra Madre, the parking concerns at the lower school campus on Highland. And we will be addressing all of those. But if there's anybody here who happens to be here that would like to speak to an item that is not on this agenda, please come forward to the podium. You got 3 minutes. We do have a packed house, so we're going to ask that you stick to 3 minutes. State your name
My name is Tony Brandenburg. I live at 153 North Lima Street. I want to thank the City Council for taking the interest into the creation of Sierra Madre liaison to PUSD to sort out this middle school mess, as well to thank the City Council members Kerber and Capocha, as well as PUSD board member Phelps for their attendance at the Sierra Madre School Summit last month. As I have shared, I often attend PUSD board meetings and will run over any resolutions that you may have or any items that you need read into public comment at regular board meetings. I believe it's important to hold the PUSD to the proposed timelines for the completion of the upper campus and hope that Sierra Madre City Council will stay active and informed on any items that involve Sierra Madre children. As you are aware, our City Council made an appointment to the redistricting task force, and whether intended or not, the outcome was that Sierra Madre lost its representation on the Board of Education until 2015. The current representative, as well as the representative for the last 2 years, has been Ed Honowitz, who, after meeting with a group of Sierra Madre parents in January of 2011 regarding my child and his educational placement in violation of FERPA, IDEA, and privacy rights, has taken an unusually silent role in issues involving the construction of this school and student safety. Mr. Honowitz is the chair of the Facilities Subcommittee and a member of the Budget and Finance Subcommittee. Mr. Honowitz had been involved in the Sierra Madre situation that he had no business being involved in, while neglecting this community in a situation that he should have been involved in. As this is not an agendized item, I wish to remind Mr. Honowitz that comment on this item is neither desired nor warranted. The Board of Education will appoint a representative for this subdistrict after the March 2013 election. This was the result of the redistricting subcommittee and the subsequent election vote, one which voters in our city rejected flat out, but which was forced upon us by default through our affiliation with PUSD. It adds insult to injury to have representatives chosen for us and not by us. And it is the opinion of this speaker that Sierra Madre community has a right to be represented by a person of our choice through a democratic process, not chosen for us by the Board of Education. It's my hope that the city will put forth a candidate to serve in this capacity until the 2015 election, and hopefully that will be someone with the best interests of all of our children, and not just some of them. It is my sincere hope that the individual will take a more active and proactive role in the future matters than our past representatives have, and that the Board of Education consider very carefully
about
before appointing anyone to take this role. John, I brought you a St. Anthony. This is the patron saint of lost things. We've lost our vote in this city. I'm going to give this to John to hold on to us for 2 years.
Thank you, Mr. Brandenburg.
Hi, I'm Mary Brandenburg. According to Steve Miller, the Director of Human Resources, PUSD has no process to investigate the actions of community members while on any PUSD campuses. This was verified at the Parent Summit last week by Mr. Sahakian, the Director of Child Welfare. There also is no plan for adult-on-child harassment or bullying at Sierra Madre School. This is of significant concern, especially when law enforcement is the sole protector of the peace. Memorandum of Understanding, MOU. Currently, there's no memorandum of understanding between PUSD and the Sierra Madre Police Department. I'm a parent of an autistic child who was escorted by the police, not to our home, but to Sierra Madre School without notice. This escort was a response to phone calls made by a parent group who were taken out of our home in 2010. This group also met in Memorial Park and then filed two false assault police reports against our then 7-year-old child. The police responded with an agency assist call to Sierra Madre School, whereby my son was segregated from all access to his peers and his education based on these parent actions for an entire year. We are grateful for the understanding shown to our family by the Sierra Madre Police Department. However, a clear understanding needs to be in place with all police agencies involved with PUSD students, including Sierra Madre, through an MOU. I don't want any more community members supporting the school-to-prison pipeline simply because they don't understand variances in behaviors or learning abilities, or because they have a personal grudge against the child's parents. PUSD has stated that they cannot control these community type of situations, which can occur on any PUSD campus. How can we keep our children safe from community members who don't have the best interests of other children at heart? Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Brandenburg. Any other members of this audience care to speak to items that are not on this agenda? All right, I will bring it back to Joint Council. And we will move on to action or to discussion item one, an update on the construction of Sierra Madre Middle School. I'll let the city manager introduce this one. I think she'll probably just introduce John Gundry, the superintendent.
I'm not sure if, is your microphone on at the bottom? There should be a button on the bottom.
Yeah, that's a different
and
one.
These the ones. Superintendent Wright will, okay. will take this report.
And just for all of you who are guests here, when you speak, please turn on the microphone, but leave them off when you're not speaking. Otherwise, if they're all on together, then we get this annoying hum. So we try to keep it like that.
Yes, John Papalardo, who's our chief finance officer, who also is currently in charge of facilities, is going to give the update.
Thank you very much, Superintendent Gundry, Sierra Madre City Council, Pasadena Board of Education. Our first item is a construction update, and if we want to probably take the first two items together, because they really do go together. We're looking at the construction update and also an update on the Measure TT funds. So those are the first two items, and then we can do parking after
I'm amenable to that, Council. Are we all okay with that? We're fine with that.
Very good.
You're fine, Mr. Mayor.
So the update, I think if we start big on the global picture of construction funds in PUSD and how that relates to Sierra Madre, going back to November of 2008, the community passed Measure TT, a $350 million school construction bond. That money was to be leveraged with state monies and other local funds for a total of $465 million in a facilities master plan district-wide. Unfortunately, a number of these funds on the matching funds did not come through for various reasons, and the economy in California in early 2009 turned south really quickly. So some of the capital facilities funds, which were budgeted at $25 million over about a seven-year period, are probably going to be closer to $4 million. Deferred maintenance in the state of California was wiped out that year and has not been restored. And there's been a number of other fundings. Career technical education funds do not exist right now in California. They may come to fruition possibly in a 2014 statewide bond election. So we're looking at that possibility. But know that we are always looking at state funds and the state program and how we can leverage the money. So with that knowledge, this past summer, we had to go back through the what was a $465 million master plan and bring that down to closer to $380 million. So through that process, the goal was to look district-wide and reduce funds by about 20% across the board. And for the Sierra Madre projects, we were looking at the elementary school or the lower campus going from about a $6 million total project to about $4.7 million, and the upper campus or the middle school about $38.7 million to about $32.1 million total. So that process is complete. We are now moving forward with it. As you, I believe, are all aware, we did have bids for the upper campus, the middle school, and they came in right at about $29 million of the about $22.5 million projected construction fees. So we have been working diligently over the past month and a half. Fraser Thompson, the owner's rep, who has been working with this project in the community for a number of years now, is here to answer any more detailed questions, but I can say that by the end of this month, we plan on having the value engineering process complete, and we'll be going back through the school community talking about the project and what's been value engineered. In all, we believe that we will be looking at a 4 to 5 month delay on this piece. If we want to go back to the beginning, the plans were submitted to DSA in mid-2010. The upper campus was demolished in the summer of 2010 with the goal at the time was that the DSA plans would be out in the fall of that year, October, November. The idea at the time was that the demolition needed to take place in order to rebuild the new school, and that the summertime was really the best time and the only time to be able to demolish the school. So in order to fast track the project, it was decided to demolish the school. In retrospect, it was a huge mistake. I'd like to stand here and apologize for that. It was a big mistake when we look at it and now what happened in DSA, and we certainly do regret that sincerely. So our goal now is to get that project bid as quickly as possible in the next 75 days or so. Our goal is we will be taking the bid out to the entire construction community. We will not be using the pre-qualified list that we identified a few months ago. Our plan is to get the best price we can for the price for the plans we have now and to move forward with that. So it's been a commitment within the facilities subcommittee. It's our number one priority at this time that Mr. Thompson has been working on. The architect for the school is here also to answer any questions. And that basically is where we are. So I'd like to open it up to any questions or discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Papalardo. Council members, questions at this time for the Chief Finance Officer of Pasadena Unified School District. Councilmember Capocha.
Mr. Papalardo, can you just reiterate the timeline again? I think once before you were a little bit more specific about what steps were going to happen leading up to construction.
Excellent question. I will invite Fraser Thompson to come up and give us the detail on that so I don't mix up my weeks and my months. That's right.
Good evening again, Mr. Mayor, members of the board, members of the council. Would you mind repeating the question again, please?
Yes, Mr. Thompson. I'm just looking for a specific timeline. What are the major milestones between now and start of construction? Well, even finish, start and finish for construction. I know you had said before that you're doing the value engineering or re-engineering.
Yes.
And then the next step is, and the next step after that is, and by when?
Certainly. Again, to reiterate for some of the members of the audience who may not have heard me say this before, when it comes to Sierra Madre schools and the Sierra Madre project specifically, I think the term value engineering has negative connotations. To me, it implies that we're taking things out. They will cease to exist on the project, that we are simply removing them for the benefit of cost. That is not the case with what we're going through on the Sierra Madre upper campus. So the first milestone after the bid was rejected was to work with the architect in one effort, and in a parallel effort work with another independent engineering firm to identify what were the major cost drivers on the project that we could re-engineer for better value to help us bring that bid price down to something closer to the budget. The second milestone was actually January 18th, which we had set as a date to be complete with the review and to start re-estimating and integrating some of these re-engineering ideas. The third milestone will be the second week of February. I haven't set a definitive date for it yet, but the second week of February we'll have a meeting where we'll bring the architect together with our independent consultant. We'll look at the ideas that they had, the ideas that the architect had, see where there's some overlap, and then begin the integration process to pull all those ideas together into the bid set of drawings that will go out onto the street. I think it apt and appropriate to emphasize the fact that we are not looking to go back to DSA with any of these changes. They are efficiency changes, architectural accent changes. They are not structural changes. I'm estimating right now it'll be 2 to 4 weeks for the architect to incorporate those ideas into the plans completely and to come up with a fair estimate of where we believe the bid will come in when it goes back out. That will put us right at the end of March. At the end of March, we will put the...
I didn't get that. I mean, if it started second week of February and it's two to four weeks...
4 weeks would be middle of March.
Second week of March at the latest.
Okay.
Okay.
But we do have to put another estimate together.
Yeah. Okay.
So once everything's integrated, then we'll have to go back and estimate it again.
Okay.
One of the things that I'm very head shy about doing is sending anything out to bid, not having a good idea of where it's going to come back cost-wise. We were able to estimate one of our recent projects in about 2 weeks. It actually took 3 weeks. It should have taken 2 weeks. So again, I'm sitting right now, last week of March.
Okay.
At that point, we'll begin the advertising process. By law, we must advertise for 2 consecutive weeks, and then we must give 10 days after that for the job walk to take place. As Dr. Papalardo mentioned, the job walk this time will be open to all potential bidders who can bond up to $25 million. That should put us, if you're tracking with me, about the middle of April. I believe third week of April. At that point, we will give our potential bidders 8 weeks to bid the project. 8 weeks instead of 6 weeks because it's a very large scope. There's 386 sheets in this drawing set. We may be dealing with bidders that have not dealt with the Pasadena Unified School District before. So I expect that there'll be a lot of questions during the bid process, given the fact that it's also falling under the umbrella of the CWA. I want to make sure that all the subs have the opportunity to talk to our representatives about what their obligations are, what the trade's obligations are. So in an 8-week bid period, that would put us out in June. So I anticipate receiving bids back in the second or third week of June on this project.
Okay, then how long before you award the bid? Do you have to analyze the bids and then select a contractor and award it?
We would, yes. We do take, usually the bid return date is structured so that it gives us approximately 5 days before we put together a report and recommendation for the facility subcommittee. Mm-hmm. The facility subcommittee will first vet the bid, give us their opinion on it, and make a recommendation as to whether or not to take it to the full board. I'm sorry, I don't have my calendar with me. I cannot tell you at this time when the board meeting is in June. Otherwise, I'd be able to give you a better idea when that date is.
Perhaps one of the board members knows.
Second Tuesday?
And fourth.
The fourth.
So that would be the fourth Tuesday.
The 11th?
So the 25th.
Okay, so we would be, in all likelihood, because the facility subcommittee meetings fall in opposite weeks to the board meetings. So we would be aiming for taking it to the board with a recommendation on the 25th.
June 25th?
June 25th.
Okay, so assuming everything goes well and the board approves it, then how long before construction actually would start? And then how long do you expect the construction to take?
The contractor is then obligated to get us all their bond and insurance documents before we can issue any kind of notice to proceed. The notice to proceed process itself usually goes very quickly. It's usually complete within 10 days after the bid award. With a notice to proceed of this magnitude, I'm not guessing, I know that the contractor is not going to proceed before the documents are in place. Mm-hmm. So if you were to say the 5th of July, right after the July 4th weekend, mm-hmm. Would be the day that you actually see us on site.
Okay.
Turning dirt.
And how long is the construction period expected to last?
At this point, the construction itself is projected to be 20 months.
20 months, okay. Okay, thank you very much.
Certainly.
Any other questions for Mr. Thompson or Dr. Pappalardo? I've got a follow-up question for the board, more likely, is if the bids all come back and they're still not within that $22 to $23 million range, what action is taken at that point? And by the way, I'd like to thank Renata Cooper for also joining us this evening.
I can speak to that. I mean, essentially, you know, we need to work within the overall budget scope of the entire bond project, and so we have budgets allocated for each site and budgets for administrative costs. And in the best of all worlds, every project comes in under budget. In the world where maybe that doesn't happen, we have to look at, in the scheme of things, are there other areas that where we have some budget surpluses? We are doing a overall look at the revised master plan, again with a eye toward ensuring that we're building our latest demographic data into the whole facilities master plan. So there's still, you know, there's a lot of the bond project still to go. So there's room, you know, I mean, no other project wants to say, sure, descope me so that you can fund another project that came in high. But in reality, there'll be some push and pull as we go forward. There's a point where, you know, if the bids again came in significantly higher than, you know, like the first time, I can't imagine that happening because there's already sort of a baseline number for understanding what was, you know, out on the street. So, you know, we're hoping to get as close as we can to the our target budget, and if there's an overage, we'll have to pick it up and look at where it would come out of the overall balance of the project.
We would expect to hear from the facilities subcommittee before it comes back to us about how the bids came in, and we would know if we were going to have a problem prior to coming to vote on it. So I am hopeful that in it, we started the process again with the last set, that people will understand, the bidders will understand that we sort of mean for them to keep to the budget.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, Supporter.
The other board member that sits in the subcommittee facilities, I've sat there for the past 4 years, Mr. Selinsky's not here today. But there's basically two narratives, right? What hasn't been discussed is how we got here, right? Several years, and we've yet to turn over dirt. And the children of Sierra Madre have just a pile of dirt to look at, right?
Yep.
And if we don't discuss how we got here, we're bound to repeat the same mistakes, right? I can tell you from day one, there was, and again, I'm going to state quite frankly, there's two narratives here. So if there's a rebuttal from my colleague, that's fine. I've lived through it for 4 years. But from the very beginning, we were very understaffed in terms of capacity. When we had the second team come on board, they said so as much. And it's in the minutes of the facility subcommittee. When you're queuing up so many projects, you have to build the capacity to run parallel projects. And so what happens when you're last in line, as many of our other schools are, they'll have less funds to build. And we've seen that. It's factual now. We've had to reduce 20%. And we see that Sierra Madre may have to reduce yet again. Now, to value engineer a shortfall or a difference of 40%, it's not practical, right? Value engineering comes within the scope of probably $1 million or two, but not several million dollars. And so what the current staff has done under Papalardo is to basically open up the bids. I'm personally in favor of that. We were basically hogtied to pre-qualified six, right? So now we've opened up to the full market. Yeah. So I believe that's a good move from the current staff that's heading facilities. I'm very confident that we'll come closer to the number. But let's speak frankly here, right? We're talking about equity. We're talking about true representation. And we'll soon have a board that is missing a crucial part of the school board, which is part of Sierra Madre. I've heard a lot of that been discussed, but we have to also remember that East Pasadena is part of this new district as well, and they also have a voice in it. But I take the point of Sierra Madre's community that there needs to be a voice, just like West Altadena and so forth are proud that they will now have a voice at the full board. So let's say what happens, right? Let's say it still comes over 2 or 3 million. Well, the decision has to be made, which is a courageous decision. Do we then what? Do we say we throw it out again, and then by economics we have inflation or deflation and so forth, inflation of material and so forth. So the longer we wait, obviously, right, we have less purchasing power. The way I calculate, or anybody could calculate, it would take us up to 7 years from when the bond was approved to finally, you know, put a shovel in the dirt. So, you know, I would like to put on the table that sooner or later there has to be a call to action. There has to be a resolution on the table that says no matter what the bids are, if it comes within a certain amount, that school must be built. If it doesn't, what's going to happen is, you know, you're going to kick the can down the road, and that's what's happened for several years. You could have all the mea culpas in the world, right? But these kids have spent several years in bungalows and trailers. It's a simple decision by everyone. Either this is right or wrong. And if it's wrong, we build.
Thank you, board member.
I just wanted to add, I mean, there's never been any discussion at all about not building the project. So I think we should just keep that in mind. We certainly need to bring it in under budget at budget or hopefully as close as possible.
Mr. Mayor.
Councilmember Gerber.
To Board Member Honowitz's question, I'm going to read the list of the board members attending, and I'm sorry that Board Member Selinsky couldn't join us. Board Member Cooper, Board Member Honowitz, Board Member Pomeroy, Board Member Kenny, Board Member Miramontes, Board Member Phelps, Superintendent Gundry, and CFO Pappalardo, which among you, because no one has done it to this point, will guarantee that this school will be built?
I think it's probably my responsibility. I'm the president of the board. We've always maintained that we were going to build the school.
Are you guaranteeing it, Ms. Cooper?
I'm guaranteeing as much as possible. I mean, I can't.
That's not a guarantee.
Well, okay, then it's not. But I have committed to the parents that I will build, that this school will be built. It was never our intention not to build the school. And I would have never voted to tear the old one down had I known. But how could I? That's what I mean. How could I have known that we were going to get hung up in DSA? How could I have known there would have been a slowdown of all the state offices? There's just all, everything that could have gone wrong with this process did go wrong. But we thought it was going to expedite things, but I would have absolutely never voted, approved the demolishing of the old school if I'd had even the slightest inkling of what would have happened. It was never our intention to deprive the children of this community of middle school.
Mr. Mayor, I believe the City Council and the community deserves a frank response. What it takes is a resolution. What it takes is a resolution in the next scheduled meeting of the school board to make a resolution to that fact, to create a binding, right, legal document that says we will build that school. Now, the second question that should have been asked is, at what capacity?
Right.
I could easily stand here and say we'll build the school, could be at 40% capacity.
Right.
Good point.
That's right. Okay.
Moreover, and I'm going to share this, what I shared to my colleagues 4 years ago in closed session is what I produced from the Gilroy Telegraph. It was a story about then Chief of Facilities, Brinkman, where there was a story, and you can research it, it's going to take you, I think you have to pay the database now, that he was the mastermind behind building the new Gilroy High School. It was never built under his tenureship because it ran out of money. That's a fact. I brought it to the attention of then Superintendent Diaz and the board. So to say that there was no inkling of an idea that then Chief was out of his capacity is not telling the truth.
I'd like to add, I mean, we could come back with a resolution that says we all, you know, vote that we're going to build the middle school. I don't think there's, frankly, that wouldn't be very much of a contentious issue. I don't think I have yet to hear anyone say, let's not build it. So we could certainly do a lot of grandstanding here, and we could give you a resolution if you think that would, you know, be useful. To me, the issue is this. We said that we would build a middle school, and I think the issue that you should pay attention to is, what's the capacity that the middle school is being built to? So the classroom capacity is the same as what was originally proposed, because in fact, what we had looked at doing was not just duplicating the old rundown campus that, you know, I mean, my daughter went there. It was no gym, I can assure you. And we were going to expand the capacity to increase the attendance zone to encompass portions of East Pasadena. That's still the plans. That's what's being bid. That's what the entire discussion that you just heard was about. So we can send you copies of the plans if you would like to see those, and you can see that it's the exact same numbers of classrooms, et cetera. If it's useful, if you think having a resolution from the board would make people feel any better, I mean, the board could do that. I think we're kind of creating a false issue as if there's a chance it might not get built. I don't think that's a reason that's even been raised at all. So, you know, the bid process is underway, and you know, I encourage the community to, you know, take a look at the plans, take a look at what's going on, and you know, the intent is certainly to have it in place as quickly as possible. The original bid numbers came in significantly higher than the architect. We could have the architect speak to that if. I don't know if someone is here from PBS, and you could hear, you know, specifics about what I'm saying. PBWS, rather.
That won't be necessary, Mr. Honowitz. And please, by all means, I certainly would like to hear from the other board members, but situation is I'm not asking for a resolution from the board. I'm asking for, you know, some of you, one of you, all of you, to personally, you know, your word is your bond, that this school is going to get built. Because basically we've got a field there, and we've got a field there, and another year goes by, and we've got a field there. And it's not even a nice field.
Superintendent Gundry.
I'd like to add that although I don't have the authority to promise that on my own, I am very much convinced that the school's going to be built and that it's going to be a great school. And you know, I think where we see the commitment of the district and the board is the fact that earlier this school year, the board approved my recommendation to maintain the there was a classroom building that was potentially going to be cut from the plans as they were trying to find a 20% reduction in the project. And my recommendation to the board was to not cut that classroom because we would like to locate our Mandarin Chinese dual language program that's currently at Field. We'd like to have the middle school program come to Sierra Madre Middle School. And so we needed that classroom space in order to be sure that we could accommodate this, which is one of our signature programs that that we're very proud of and that is continuing to grow and that we think will continue to grow in the future. And so the board is committed to this, and I as a superintendent, the district staff, this is a great program that we think is going to continue to grow. And we're actually, you know, I can't imagine this school not being built. You know, and the decision to locate our middle school dual language program there was made earlier this year, September. I think it was back in September when the board approved that. And so that just illustrates the commitment of the board, the superintendent and staff to making this a great middle school where we're going to locate one of our wonderful signature programs.
Thank you, Superintendent Gundry.
Yep.
Mayor Pro Tem.
First of all, when I first heard of this difference, the gap between what was budgeted or what you estimated the cost was going to be and then what the proposals were, it was stunning to me, the difference in that amount. It was just stunning. And I don't know who doing a budget would make that kind of an error. I can't imagine. I understand it was held over for several months, but that doesn't really, it's the cost of living just doesn't quite, you know, it's more than a cost of living, let's face it. So I don't know what that error was about. So I'm kind of interested in, if you're saying you're going to build a school and the capacity will be the same, but what is it that they're going to lose, you know, to fit into this budget now if you're going to bring them down to 23, 24 million? There's obviously something you're going to have to give up, and I doubt that, you know, you can just do it in finishings. I mean, that, you know, it's clearly something significant, and I'd sure like to know what that is. So, you know, maybe I would like to hear a little more about the detail as to what gets lost in this, because it's one thing to say you're going to have the classrooms and the capacity, but then I don't know if capacity is covering anything more than the number of students served in the classrooms. So, you know, what else has to be given up?
I think that is a good question for the architect, and he is here, so he can come up and speak to some of those items, because I think he and Mr. Thompson have been discussing those items.
Good evening, members of the board, city council. I'm Wade Frazier with PBWS Architects, and I've been part of this process all the way through, along with Frazier. And it's very distressing to me where we're at this point in time, as it is with you. When we started out designing this school, it was in the very beginning, the master plan for this school was modernization with some additions. And with the budget that we were working with in the beginning, we just developed a plan where we could actually build a new school and increase the capacity. And that capacity is a middle school for 550 students. That's what the plans still are designed for. There's several items, and we don't have all the effects of that how we got to this point figured out as of yet. As Fraser mentioned earlier, the district has hired a construction consultant to help analyze the bids and to see where we're at and why we're where we are at. We have also been doing some investigating of that as ourselves. And I admittedly think that our initial estimate was certainly under where we should have been. We did start with a significantly higher budget, a construction budget of almost $29 million, and we need to bring this down to approximately $22.5 million. When we started that process, our estimates, we thought we were closer to that than we were, but we still made some value engineering efforts at that time to get to the district's new master plan. Some of the physical elements that we're looking at are simplifying quite a bit of the exterior finishes, and it was a fairly complicated project as far as the exterior finishes and detailing, so there is quite a bit there. Initially, when we started planning the school, we were looking at quite a few sustainability elements as well. In fact, we started the design with the idea of getting a sustainability certification, and quite a few of those elements are fairly costly to do, and so that's another area, a major area that we're looking at. Also, some of the complexity of the systems that we've designed. We're not taking out air conditioning and heating, but we're looking at the complexity of the system that we're designing and trying to simplify those systems so they are more efficient from a cost standpoint and a construction standpoint. There are elements on the site that we're simplifying, some of the materials that we're using for paving and so on. And that we're looking at that to help get us part of the way. We think that there were some issues with the methodology of the first bidding, how that was handled. We didn't anticipate some of the cost escalation in construction. For the last 4 or 5 years, we had been dealing with an almost flat increase in construction costs. And within about the last year, there's apparently been some escalation, and it's continuing. So we have to take that into account as well. So I don't have all the specific details of what we're looking at, but I think a major part of it is looking at exterior finishes, systems, possibly opening up some of the standardized items that the district has now, looking at more options for those. In an ideal world, money no object, we would try to standardize as many things as we could, but I think there is a cost to that, so we have to look at options for those kinds of things as well. And a lot of those have to do with the maintenance and operation side of the district.
Thank you.
Thank you. I hope we have an opportunity to hear you again once this is nailed down a little bit, find out what's going to happen. And I guess my next question is for the board, and that is, if you have a couple million dollars, if they're over by a couple million than what you think you're going to be able to pay, how do you know these issues aren't going to also exist with some of the other projects that you have on the table for the other schools, that they won't have these kinds of issues with bids, and how flexible can you be in terms of moving, a couple of million to around, shifting around, because that's what you were talking about, was shifting some funds around from one project to another. So are you really afforded that kind of manipulation, and how much heartburn is that going to cause other schools?
Well, I'll go ahead and take that one.
All right.
Real quick. So currently there's about $12 million in contingency. We're looking at about a $380 million total budget. We've spent about $111 million. We have about $270 million to go. and about $12 million in contingency, so somewhere around 4%. It's not a very large contingency at this point, as you can see. What we've done is we've hired a firm to go through, and we alluded to it a little bit earlier, looking at our total master plan from not from Sierra Madre, but let's just say July 1 of this year and out, as to all of the other projects that we're doing. And we're looking specifically at new construction, district-wide, some of the modernization programs. We have to look at it in context of our current enrollment and our projected enrollment. When the facilities master plan was developed in 2007-08, we had about 2,000 more students than we do today. So we're looking at those projects that are coming up in the future, not Sierra Madre, not McKinley, but all the other projects, and looking at that. I believe there may be some projects that we have on the books that probably aren't warranted with our current enrollment patterns. Let's just be straight up about it. That's what we're looking at right now. So our goal really is, you know, to have something more like a 8% contingency at this time. So that $12 million or so, I imagine, could grow to $25 million. Could be 28, 30 million, but we'll be looking at that in the spring. So when we talk about the case of a few million dollars, I mean, realistically, I do not believe the bids, when we rebid and we're looking at them in June, will be under $26 million. That's just, I mean, I really don't believe that, and I'll look over at my two professionals, and I've got one nodding that, yeah, both of them are nodding their heads. We're really probably looking at a closer to $26 million minimum bid, and so we're going to award it at that, and we'll have a better review of the master plan. We know we have the $12 million in contingency now. We'd hope to have by the end of this fiscal year, June 30th, to look at the other projects, because we simply need to look at our current capacity and what we're doing.
Thanks. I'm feeling a little better.
That actually was great news, I think, for us to hear. Councilmember Harvey.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
I know Board Member Pomeroy has been raising her hand. I think maybe you did.
I did miss that. Thank you, Councilmember Carver.
That's all right. I just wanted to say that I don't think any individual board member can guarantee a decision by the full board. But you asked each of us by name, and I want to reply that I can give you my personal commitment that I will never vote to see any canceling this project or anything that would permanently derail it in any way. So you have my commitment for that. A couple of weeks ago, I went walking on the campus just to see what was there, what it was like. And so I have seen it firsthand just within the last week or two. And I see it's something that we must keep at a very high priority, perhaps the highest priority of these building projects. And also, if there is to be a resolution, I tell you that I would support a resolution to make this even more firm. I also think that it would be good to bring some visuals to this council as soon as we can, some drawings, something to look at about this area may be in phase two, but the rest of it will be complete, or something, so that you have that to look at.
That would be
but
great.
But you have that commitment from me.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Board Member.
If I could just briefly, I just want to thank Board Member Pomeroy. Thank you. I appreciate
Absolutely.
Your commitment.
Councilmember Harvey.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Has Prop 30 helped at all? I mean, I understand that before Prop 30, things looked worse, and I'd just like to know exactly how Prop 30 affected the district and whether any of that money helps with some of this flexibility.
Prop 30 was really strictly a general fund issue, mm-hmm. and so we're talking here about all the capital facilities money. So it did not affect the building plan. What it did affect was the district's ability to function in an ongoing basis. Our estimate was that if Prop 30 failed and the governor implemented the mid-year reductions he was talking about, that about half of the districts in the state of California would be bankrupt this fiscal year. And we were very close into that top half, bottom mm-hmm. half. We were right at about the midpoint of that. So it was a significant relief. It was to the general fund, where we were looking at potentially $22+ million in reductions next year on a $180 million budget. I mean, 15% across. It was really, really significant. And it passing really took that particular pressure off. And then the governor's January 10th budget proposal for next year also is looking like it's going to be helpful for us in that.
And I guess the reason I ask is because Mr. Honowitz mentioned that the administrative costs are still an issue, and that Measure TT bonds are still paying for administrative costs that are related to this project and the other capital projects. Is that not correct, or?
I missed Mr. Honowitz's comment on that. I'm sorry.
Two things to clarify that. Mm-hmm. Just first, in relation to Prop 30, to kind of contextualize this, we were looking at before the, if Prop 30 had failed, we might have had as $22, $24 million in cuts. With the passage of Prop 30, we were looking at in the range of $12 million in cuts, and now with the governor's budget, which has added in a little additional for schools, we're looking maybe in the $8 to $10 million in cuts. So has Prop 30 made a difference? It's made a huge difference, but we're still making cuts, like many districts across the state of California. So that's sort of the contextual issue around our operating budget. All of this that we're talking about in relation to the school site and the construction is the facility budget, which is separate pot of money. So what I was referring to in terms of the administrative costs are, we have an allocation for each project, and then there is also a central administration, which is basically operating the entire bond mm-hmm. project. So that was what that reference
right.
was.
Right, and I understood that, and my question was, could any of that Prop 30 money help account for any of those administrative costs, or are you keeping those completely separate?
No, because we can't use we can't use our facility budget to operate the school district, and because they're capital funds, and the bond language specifically restricts mm-hmm. how we could do that.
But you could use your general funds.
Could we theoretically take our general funds and start to augment Measure TT, et cetera? We could, but mm-hmm. we're facing $8 million in or more in cuts, and so it's probably not realistic that we could backfill capital projects given the huge reductions that we're seeing in operating costs.
And I get my question to Mr. Popolardo is, how much of the money, the Measure TT money, is being spent on administrative functions? For example, Mr. Thompson, his salary, I'm sure it's worth it, but is that being paid purely from Measure TT money, or is
yeah.
that being paid
yeah,
from...
Yeah, and that's a real good question. Right now, there's a lot of different layers to that, but I'll just say our current budget on administrative costs is centrally is about $7.7 million, and that's on the $380-some-odd million. So we're looking at about 2%, you know. And if you think of a construction management firm, some of these firms that are out there that do it, they'll come in and charge anywhere from 6 to 8, sometimes 10% on a high end. You know, on average, about 5% administrative costs is what you'd be looking at. So mm-hmm. from a central standpoint, we're looking at somewhere just over 2%. Now there's also, we're allocating the costs of project management directly to the programs, and the programs right now, the construction projects, whether new construction or modernization, we've got built in 20% what's called soft costs, and that's for the architect fees, inspector records, project management, geological surveys, and all of that. So that's very, 20% is a good number to be at. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, there's districts that look at 30%, 35%. I won't even talk about LA Unified's very first bond when they spent $2 billion, of which about 90% was on soft costs. But
I think
I digress there. So I think the management from a central perspective, looks good as the numbers I've looked at over the last
But I think
months.
The takeaway is, especially with some of the issues with the management up to this point, is the longer this takes, and I'm sure the board is very well aware of this, the more money that the Measure TT money will be spent more on administration and less on building. So I think that is something that we need to consider. And then just going forward, next steps, we mentioned that this is the number one priority of the facility subcommittee, or it might be of the board. What exactly does that mean? And I guess this is a question to the board itself. How often are we going to be revisiting this project as a board? Are we going to be inviting a representative from Sierra Madre to attend, participate in these discussions? What do we have in mind?
Well, let me jump in. Again, this is my opinion. But as Councilman Correa said, you wanted some commitments. But let's look at the political calculus here. There's two board members here that are stepping down, and the other three are running for re-election. The only one we know for certain that's going to stay here is Renata Cooper. You may have a whole new face here in 3 or 4 months. We're the last board to be elected at large. In other words, Sierra Madre is all our constituents, right? When I look at Sierra Madre, they're my constituents. This is all ending now because now we have districts. Now you'll have elected board members are competing in their own tight geographic location. The reality is they're going to fight for every penny as well for their own facilities. Right? And that's the new political calculus. Mm-hmm. And again, there could be a counter narrative to that, but that's the reality of it, right? So what you have in front of you is the last at-large board. And we're all so Sierra Madre is our constituents. And as Councilman Walsh, you asked a very open-ended question, very poignant. What if the bids come out to be only 2 or 3 or 4 million? There's nothing that prevents us from saying, yes, we'll fund that gap. We could do that, right? Dr. Pomeroy has already said that she was probably to that effect supported. I've already stated that I would even submit the resolution that binds us financially, right, that we do that. We're sure we could get a second, so forth. But you have I believe, in my humble opinion, you have a limited timeline here, that you have us in front of you. The community has us right now. And we should be called, right, to account if we're going to fully build out what was promised to Sierra Madre. I'll tell you why that's something I would support. Unlike other geographic locations of Pasadena, they have a school. There is no Sierra Madre Middle School. That's it. I mean, if you think this takes courage, I don't know what does. I mean, this is, to me, an easy vote. So to your I think, pointed question to all of us, we could do this. I have confidence in the current team and what they've kind of are going to cast a wider net in terms of competitive bids. You, I think, see a board leaning towards funding a gap, right, the gap that may happen. But you should keep our feet to the fire.
Yeah, and I guess my point would be that if you could institutionalize, if the board can start thinking about some of those ways, and you know, there's some ideas that we can talk about, but I think there's ways of institutionalizing that, and that is quite possibly having someone, a representative from Sierra Madre, at your meetings, sitting on the dais. Might not be a voting member, but might be someone that can take part in the conversation. I understand that Mr. Honowitz will technically be our representative for the 2 years, but I think that there are ways to making sure that this happens in a more concrete way.
I think you just gave some people a heart attack. That's not the case.
Is that not the... I'm sorry.
No, you gave me a heart attack.
Is it someone else? I'm sorry.
No, I'm not running for re-election, so I am. Well, I'm my term ends in May.
Okay. Well,
I think
someone else.
I mean, just what I would suggest is, I mean, we're going through this process, like many districts in the state, based on the California Voting Rights Act, of changing from at-large to sub-district trustee area elections. So there isn't, like, a process for you to have a board member based on Measure A and the language and what was voted on by the people, right, in June. There isn't a process for you to have an elected sub-district board member until 2015, but there certainly is no reason, and in fact we should have representation from members of Sierra Madre, and in fact they regularly tend to attend our facilities meetings and board meetings, etc., so that your voice is heard like every other constituent group out there. I think at the end of the day, even if I would just say we should, let's work within the realm of the facts and what's going forward. We could actually commit to all kinds of things, and a new set of board members could do a 180-degree change and say, you know, now our priority is, you know, we're going to take all that money and build the Taj Mahal over here in some other area. I wouldn't spend a lot of energy worrying about that personally. That's my recommendation, because I think there's a commitment on the part of the staff and the board, and all of the facility plans, the master plan, the programmatic plan with the Mandarin dual language program. I just don't want us to get a whole head of steam around this doom and gloom that could possibly happen, when in fact I think you're seeing a lot of support, and that's my take on that. And again, I just encourage people to be active, come to the meetings, and get your voice heard.
Yeah, and actually, speaking of which, we do have a lot of people in the room. There were a couple of board members who didn't get a chance. There were a lot of questions asked and things like that. If you want to chime in right now, absolutely. And then I think we're going to open it up to the public. So,
I just want to add my voice as being in favor of building the Sierra Madre Middle School. Having said that, though, a caveat for me, and it actually one of the things that Dr. Pappalardo mentioned, he talked about losing, I think he said 700 middle school students since 06, 07. And actually, if you go back to 03, 04, so about 10 years ago, we've lost, I think, 1,500 middle school students. So I do think we have, overall in our district, some concerns and some planning to do about our middle school capacity and how we adjust our programs so that we are not looking at trying to close a middle school at the same time that we're building. And, you know, we just finished Blair as well. So that's a concern.
Good point.
I certainly support building the middle school. And also, I understand you might have had some discussion about Mr. Paccia representing
I've been designated as the liaison, so to speak. Well, yeah, that's a little bit of a problem here in the Sierra Madre Council, because we meet Tuesday nights as well.
Second and fourth.
Yes.
So I have also at the Parent Summit made the remark, and I certainly would support this if I'm on the board. There is a process if you do have a vacancy. The vacancy policy has been around for a long time. It has nothing to do with Measure A. Just want to establish that. It's when you have a vacancy, what do you do? So we will probably have a vacancy. Let me just say that, right? So without going into detail. So we would have to appoint a board member. And I know people don't like that the board is going to be appointing a board member. I understand that. But as I said at the summit, I would encourage people to submit their applications.
Great point.
If we do have that vacancy, as I think we will, as I said at the summit, I would encourage people to submit applications through the normal vacancy process. Because just like the Pasadena City Council had to appoint someone the other day, we'll have to appoint, I believe, or the board will have to appoint in May.
For those of you in the back, Board Member Phelps noted that there will most likely be a vacancy on this upcoming Board of Supervisors, and that they will be appointing, and that those members of our community who are interested, please fill out an application for that. Yeah. Councilmember Capocha, and then we'll open it up. That's okay.
Okay, just I think we've heard from everybody. Ms. Cooper, I wasn't sure if your commitment was as strong as, say, Board Member Pomeroy, who stated that she would not do anything to vote against it. Do you feel the same way? I mean, is this, we heard that this is the number one priority of the Facility Subcommittee, but is it the number one priority of the existing board?
It has always been a priority for the existing board.
A priority. I meant number one priority. Is it the number one priority? I'm sorry to interrupt, but that was my question.
Well, I think the financial situation of the school district has actually been the top priority, and figuring out what we're going to do with these cuts that we've been faced with. And the overall management of the district and educating the children that are sent to us has been a top priority. That the construction, it has been a top construction priority.
Okay, thank you.
And we have funding for that. So, you know, you're looking at pink slips and March 15th, and mm-hmm. you know, so I would be, feel comfortable saying it has been the top construction
okay,
priority.
Good. Okay, I would just like to say I do appreciate Mr. Miramontes and his offer to initiate a resolution with the board, and I would encourage him to do that, and hopefully we'll get a unanimous support on that, just for the record. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Capocha. We do have a lot of people in the public right now. We do ask that you come forward, state your name. There's a lot of people here, so if somebody's already stated what you're going to say in 3 minutes, please try to keep it a little bit shorter. If you have questions for any members of the Pasadena Unified School District staff regarding the construction and or the bonds, or any members of school board members, we will be noting down those questions and they can answer those afterwards. This is not going to be a question answer where you ask the question and it gets immediately answered. So ask your questions. We'll keep track of those and we'll make sure that they get answered as the evening progresses. So without any further ado, Councilmember Kerber has something to say.
Point of clarification, Mr. Mayor. I know that there's a couple of folks that have like printed copies they want to pass out, and I think I had told them the city clerk would be here, but if they could pass them to the city manager right here when you come up to speak, please. Thank you.
Absolutely. At this point, we do open up the podium for any members of the public who would care to speak to these issues.
Not hearing anything about David Ascaraga and Robin Brown and about three or four other contracts and a lot of money that has disappeared or not hasn't been accounted for unless it somehow has happened in the last 2 months. It's great to hear that Proposition 30 passed, but when this isn't a sieve, we shouldn't be dumping money into any agency. And when there was $350 million that was entrusted to the school district to build a school, we shouldn't be reading in the paper that there's an investigation and that there's a lot of money missing. I'd like to know where that investigation is right now.
Thank you, Mr. Brandenburg.
I can answer that in general terms. Actually,
Mr. Gundry, we're going to allow them to ask the questions, and then we'll come back. We'll get to that question, Mr. Brandenburg.
I'm the one who had the supporting documentation, so I'm going to go ahead and hand this to. Good evening, City Council and PUSD Board. My name is Gretchen Vance. I'm a longtime resident of Sierra Madre, a member of the PUSD Bond TT Oversight Committee, and also a mother of four children who have gone through Sierra Madre Schools or are currently in Sierra Madre Schools. My remarks this evening will be the short version of what is written to you in more detail. On July 22, 2008, the PUSD Board officially proposed Measure TT project to replace the upper campus with state-of-the-art classrooms, science and computer labs, a library, gym, multi-purpose building, and a new playfield. Our oldest son, Brock, had just finished fourth grade. If we would only vote for Measure TT that November, the architects promised that plans and permits for the new school would be done in 7 months, then 3 months for approval, 12 months of construction, and we are in. So Brock would only have to spend his sixth grade year in portables and have 2 years in the new school, and so would his younger brothers and sisters. We voted yes, as many of these other people did. We trusted the PUSD board. But Brock, with asthma, spent 3 years breathing dust. He is now a freshman in high school. Never saw that campus. Nothing's been done. Architects did not submit plans in 7 months. They submitted plans in 17 months. The state approval they promised in 3 months took 26 months. On November 28, 2012, bids were opened with lowest coming in at $29 million. Principal Newsom published an announcement to the parents this past December and said, guess what? You're going to see trucks on the grounds during Christmas break. He had to retract his announcement. The board rejected all bids and charged the architects and another consulting firm to which we are giving more TT money to remove the additional $7 million. The 2009 cost projection was 38.6 that was reduced because of state funding, as we have heard, and now the cost projection is 33. In 2011, a brand new state-of-the-art Blair Middle School opened with full Measure TT funding, and we're still sitting with our empty lot. There's no shortage of reasons and excuses surrounding the failure to build this school, but the responsibility belongs to the PUSD School Board. These are your students, high-achieving students. We trusted you to build this school. We voted for it. Now we are asking you to do the right thing. Here's the resolution. Cancel the decision to reject your bids, award the contract, and build our school.
Okay, hi. I'm Fred Thomas. I am the parent co-chair of the school site council at Sierra Madre. I'm also the chair of the African American Parents Council, and I'm also on the executive committee of that. I'm on everything, so just, and I have three daughters. First of all, thank you to the board members for being here, and thank you to our city council. It has been a long time where the parents have been fighting this battle, so it's really nice to get the city involved and get our elected officials involved, so I really want to acknowledge that. I will say that the building of the school, it's not a matter of building it, and I don't think, and I would agree, I don't think anybody has said we don't want to build the school, but it is definitely a matter of priority. And I want to kind of go back a little bit, because where I think it impacts the city of Sierra Madre is when Measure Y was introduced and we all voted, and all the residents, all the property tax owners voted for Measure Y, we kind of voted with the expectation that Sierra Madre would get some money from that. Well, we didn't. So, you know, down the road, Measure TT comes up, and now the voters are like, oh, I don't know if you're going to go to that well twice. You know, we didn't get anything from Y. But, you know, being the folks that we are, we passed it again. And now we're still kind of having an issue. Nancy, to answer your question, which I don't know how the answer didn't get raised about why there was a big difference, I can tell you why there was a big difference. When they gave us the original cost, they based it on a cost per square foot. And unfortunately, the itemized costs were kept in secret. And they came to many meetings and they said, well, this is the cost. And we said, well, where'd you get that number? Well, it's cost per square foot. Well, what's in the square foot? Well, it's the cost based on general construction of schools. So I'm really a little nervous about the value added, since it was very difficult for them to even tell us where they got that number from. So to be able to take an imaginary number and then modify it to make it a real number. I've been through a lot of school. I don't remember that class where you can, but that's another issue. Most important, as they're doing the value added, we still have not, as a community, been contacted about even what they're considering as the details of the value added, or what they're going to remove, or what they're thinking about removing. And again, if for those of us that have followed this, this is starting to have a very familiar pattern. Let's stall till summertime when the parents aren't around as much. And then let's have a bunch of meetings and see if we can slide some stuff under. And then in fall, come up with a whole new scenario for us.
About 30 seconds, Mr. Thompson.
Yeah, it might be a little bit longer, sorry. All the while, there are schools that are being built. Some of them ridiculously over budget. But most importantly, when we look at our community, we're talking about a middle school that I'm sure all of you have seen that is very, it's just not safe. And we can go down the list, we can talk about, and I encourage all of you to please go watch a PE and see what our kids are doing, and how many of them are crunched on a field that my 8-year-old daughter can hit a home run out of, because that's how small the field is. We can talk about the one piece of building that's left from the original building that is so far removed from the office that, God forbid, an emergency happened, it will take literally minutes for those words to reach, despite our principal's best efforts to, and they have done a wonderful job trying to get radios
Mr.
to all
Thompson,
the teachers and all
I'm
those
gonna
things.
Have to, I'm going to
I'm wrapping up.
Off.
I'm wrapping okay. up. So the bottom line is this. Without any hesitation, the bias that exists with regards to Sierra Madre, the fact of the matter is we are a public school. We are one of your public schools. We deserve the same considerations. There are schools that are getting TT money that got Y money. So There are schools that are getting seconds before we've even had a chance to eat a dinner. And all I'm saying is, it is time to now make Sierra Madre a priority. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Marina Munich, and I'm an eighth grader in Sierra Madre School. I think it's actually a priority to get a school for us, because we're actually doing PE and we're getting hurt. There was a kid last week that got hurt on his head because he tripped on the field and got stuck a nail in his head. And it's not safe for us to play PE or walk down. If there's an emergency, we have to walk a freaking down railing down there to get to the office. We're getting marked tardy to get to our classes, and it's unfair for us eighth graders. In sixth grade, we got promised that we were gonna be in that school in eighth grade. That's not gonna happen. I have two sisters. I'm hopefully glad that my sister in third grade's gonna get in there, but I'm not even sure that she's gonna get in there. The priority is our school, and it should come first.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Munich.
Thank you. I'm a parent as well. And we're also in the construction industry. We run a small green business company, Natural Plasters. So I'm familiar with the sustainability issues. And my question is regarding, I want to leave a record of the question to be explored further in terms of construction process. The narrative you're presenting is that the bids have been too high and that you are resubmitting this bidding process, and that somehow that's going to come out of extras in terms of surfaces. We are very aware of what that looks like in sustainability issues. But the question that I want to leave on the record is, I don't understand going outside to broaden the bidding process to people who are not, I guess, in the union or in the board. You are apparently looking for other construction bids or something under that budget. Who are these people? One of the narratives that was presented was that after the bids were in, you would take a couple weeks and you would then check their bonds and insurances. And our understanding is that you wouldn't even be able to bid for a $24 to $26 million project unless you carried that kind of insurance or coverage. So that narrative doesn't make any sense. I just want to question the building process in terms of bonds, sustainability, and have that be more transparent to what the public is being asked to cut.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Michelle Lessie. I have a daughter in seventh grade at the middle school. She's been there on that campus for 2 years now in portables. She was in portables at the elementary school for 2 years prior to that. So she's been in portables for 4 years. She's in seventh grade. She has one more year to go. Sierra Madre Elementary School is a fantastic school, and the teachers knock themselves out. It's a high-performing school in terms of parent involvement, in terms of the children's participation in studying and eating their breakfast and getting to school ready to go and hit the ground running every day. They perform at a very high level, not only on standardized tests, but for the teachers in their classroom. 2 years ago, Mr. Thompson, I sat at a meeting with you, and you were very dismissive at that time. And I told you that I was going to keep my eye out and watch. I live on East Highland, which ends at Cannon at the middle school, and it's an eyesore. Sierra Madre has a fine code enforcement officer who visits my neighbors and myself, asking us to get our tires off of our lawn. My daughter has asked why there's an empty lot that is chained off and not used. I'd like to ask for your response on that. How the facility has been left to be an eyesore, and City Council, I ask you to please make a good neighbor of the school board. And for Mr. Architect, I'm sorry I didn't catch your name when you were at the podium. One of the value added diminishments that we are expecting is the loss of air conditioning. Well, correct me if I'm wrong, I thought that was one of the presentations from a prior meeting. As a neighbor, I realize that it's an open pit and it just doesn't make sense to keep pouring money into it. And I wonder, at what point is the school board, many of you won't even be here when that decision is made, will look to cut their losses and see what they can get for the property? Is it going to be a budget remedy to sell the property? There is a point at which the returns will not be there. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to understand that the school's population is not growing.
About 30 seconds, Ms. Lessie.
Thank you. So to say that you'll be closing schools and act as if it's a surprise does not make sense. And at some point, it's not going to make sense to keep pouring money into this property, to have the consultants and the administrators continue to eat up the Measure TT funds. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Steve Stapenhorst, Sierra Madre parent, two girls in the school. They will, they're both in the present middle school. They will miss the new school when it's built. And I'm also the very proud husband of a wife who's been very involved in the school and very much a supporter of PUSD from the beginning, and very much fought for TT bond money and so forth. And my only comment is that there have been some mentions of the fact that there's a declining enrollment in PUSD. I believe you said 1,500 in the middle school, and there was a movie called Field of Dreams a few years ago, and the phrase was, if you build it, they will come. I'd like to propose a sequel, Sierra Madre, School of Our Dreams. If you don't build it, they will leave.
Hello, I have a cold. I'm a parent at Sierra Madre. I just have some simple questions, actually, that I was just confused on. I know that on the website it says the cost is $32 million for the middle school, and I've heard y'all say $21.5 million for the construction. I know that a lot of costs have gone to architectural fees and Department of State architect fees, but I don't know what that $10.5 million is going to, so I'm curious to see what is that cost. Is part of that just if it goes over budget, then there's $4 million in there, flex costs. Another thing was I moved here for Sierra Madre Elementary. I did not know what was going to happen with Sierra Madre Middle School at the time. What I had thought was going to happen is I would be able to walk my children to school. That's why we moved here, was the ability to walk to school. So if it isn't built and I am shipped off to another middle school, then I'll just move to a place where I can walk to school, because that was the whole lifestyle. This small community where my son can see his neighbors, where he can walk to school with his friends. That was the beauty of it, and you're not going to get that anywhere else. So if there's some conversation that the school board has later and thinks that the Sierra Madre parents will move to another school, that's not really what we're here for as a community. We want our children to know each other and to walk to school together. At least that's how I feel. And then another thing I had emailed before, but I had checked out the Department of State Architects site. On the site, it stated that they were waiting for a fire, light, and safety plan. And at that time, the dialogue was that that had been submitted. And then that Department of State Architects site stated that it had not been submitted. And then now it states in the comment section that they had been overridden and had decided to pass the plans after all, even though the documents hadn't been submitted in time. I know that government is very messy, and maybe somebody in the Department of State Architects office did get the plans and didn't want to admit to it, maybe, but I am a little confused. Where did that ball get dropped? Was it there, or was it here? Who's responsible? Who has oversight? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
D. Alcorn on Grandview. I think that the distress here, you see, you brought it on yourselves. There's been a very gross mismanagement in several areas of I don't know if you folks, but there's been a gross mismanagement in some areas, financial in particular. And I think that we went to the discussions when they're going to do this school. There's some glowing promises. You've heard all these things. It didn't happen. So I think you can well understand why we've heard that story before. Now, the one thing that bothers me, you said this is first priority. Yep. The first thing you did, you say we had a 20% reduction, so we made across the board 20% discount. That does not show me priority. You took a 20% across the board for everything. That is not priority. So your words don't bespeak your actions. That is, you didn't show priority. You haven't shown priority. So I question really your sincerity in what you're saying. I hope there's a tunnel or a light at the end of this tunnel. Hopefully this will help and some dialogue. But there is quite a reason to be very suspicious about this. You did not show the priority. 20% across the board doesn't show that. I wish you would consider that. What is a priority? You say it's number one priority, but you have not demonstrated that that's really what you're doing. Thank you.
Are there any other members of this audience who would care to speak to this?
Excuse me, Eric Wilson, 630 Sierra Meadow Drive, Sierra Madre. I'm fortunate in a way of having my oldest be a six-year-old who's a kindergartner now, and I just did the math, and if I'm here in 5 years and it's time for him to attend the middle school, it's going to be an entirely different issue. But I'd maybe like to, since I was the last to speak, it sounds like end on a little bit more of an optimistic note. It sounds like $26 million is a number that the district has identified as where the bids will likely land. And being working for the largest engineering firm in the world, I understand that project can be built when there's a will, there's a way. And for $26 million, something great can be built at this site. And maybe we can take the energy of tonight's meeting and translate that into a conversation about how excellent this school is going to be, rather than what if this school will actually exist. I hear about the Mandarin language program. I'm thrilled that my son would be able to participate in a program like that, and my daughter would too. So I would like to challenge the district, and I'd like to challenge the city as well, that the next time we meet, come the timeline that was discussed here tonight, the conversation isn't about if and it isn't about when. It sounds like it's going to be a 20-month process beginning in the summer. And we can all agree that we've heard that tonight, and the commitments have been made by the district, and that we're spending the time speaking about how amazing this school will be. I'm shocked as a parent of the community nursery school and the elementary school how amazing these parents are in this community. It's unbelievable. I mean, the amount of love for their children and the amount of love for their community, I mean, there's nothing like it. I've lived in California, born and raised in Altadena. I went to John Muir High School. I'm a product of PUSD. And I'd just like to say that you have an amazing opportunity here to bring a level of exposure to the district with a school that really shines as a gem within your school system. And that school would be founded by a community of parents that care about their children more than you guys have any idea. The amount of time that we spend thinking and talking about this, every parent that's spoken tonight about their children potentially moving out of town. I mean, I crunched the numbers. I moved to this town 2 years ago very specifically as not to send my children to private school. I wanted them to attend the school district that I attended. I wanted them to attend public school for 8 years and really show them the value of diversity of the public school education. And I crunched the numbers and said, I want to be in the school district where my children can live and walk to school, as we've heard from these previous commenters. So I'd like to challenge the district to change this dialogue to not an if or when, but how amazing this school will be and how we can all support you in making it that way. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Anybody else care to follow that one up?
Hi, my name is Eric Brandon. I'm a parent of two students in Sierra Madre Elementary, and I just want to make sure and very clear here that we remember. I remember standing before the board when Percy Clark was here 10 years ago, and again, there was this sense of pessimism, and we had schools that could barely make API scores of 700 and so forth. I mean, let's remember here, this is Sierra Madre Elementary, where we have API scores of over 900. I mean, that's comparable to the best districts around here. The middle school is the same way, on the same track up. And so it's important to realize, again, for myself, we could have gone to other school districts, we could have gone to private schools. We chose Sierra Madre because it's the best school in the district by far. We love Sierra Madre, we love the teachers, Ms. Halpern, Ms. Ritchie, all of our favorite teachers there have to be called out. And so it's important to realize, and we have to disavow everyone of the notion that there's a declining enrollment at Sierra Madre Elementary School. It is going up, and it continues to go up, okay? So let's make that very clear. However, if the board wavers or decides somehow to not build the middle school, I guarantee that the enrollment, as you heard earlier, will go down. And if you think the PUSD is facing an enrollment crunch, wait till that happens. And so just you have to be very, very clear that it's not a declining enrollment within Sierra Madre Middle School. It is going up, and that's why we have all the more need. And so the final thing that I would like to hear, and just echoing the previous speaker, what the board should be looking at is if this, again, is a number one priority, and I agree with the earlier comment of how could we have a 20% across the board cut if it's a priority, we should be looking at how do we accelerate things? How do we add an extra money to make this go faster? And within a project management scheme, that's within the purview. How do we add additional resources to try to accelerate this? Why does it have to be 20 months? Why can't it be 15 months? Why can't it be 12 months? It can be done. So I hope that the city council will ask those questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brandon.
Hi, my name is Lisa Milne, Sierra Madre resident, third generation. My boys are fourth generation. I hate public speaking, but this is very important to me, so here I am. My oldest son is in eighth grade this year, was supposed to be in the new campus this year, clearly didn't happen. I have a third grader. I was ever hopeful that he would get to see the new campus from beginning to end. Now I'm beginning to have serious doubts about that. One of the things I really like about our community is not only do we have our Sierra Madre kids, but we also have Pasadena and Altadena kids. And you talk about dwindling students going to our Pasadena schools. Actually, those children are now going to be turned away at the middle school level because of the Chinese immersion. So you have all those children who would like to go to our middle school who won't be able to because of the Chinese immersion school going there. Without the Chinese immersion, I think you would have enough children to fill this school that are on permit, that are siblings, or just people who want their kids to go to the school from Pasadena and Altadena. So I'm a little sad to see that going away. But I think that in this case, we do not have dwindling students going to this school. So I hope that you will go ahead and build this campus and not use the excuse that it's been empty or that enrollment is going down. I have a couple other little things. You say 20% has gone away from all campuses. However, Blair, for instance, already has their state-of-the-art building. So what can you cut from them? Whereas 20% from us is huge since we have no campus. Another thing is it really scares me that you're opening the bidding to everyone. On the one hand, I'm happy about that, but I would like to see those people be pre-qualified for their bonds and things, because we know from experience from even our lower campus that from previous buildings, we've lost contractors and stuff because they've absconded with some of our funds. So please make very sure that if you're opening this to people that who have not worked for PUSD successfully before, that these people have worked somewhere successfully before so that we don't end up in that situation again. Let's see, where else? I was making notes as everyone was talking earlier, so I did not plan on speaking.
A lot of talk has been talked about value engineering and what's been coming out. I haven't heard specifically what any of those things are. However, I did go to a middle school meeting where our principal told us that he was at a previous district meeting where some of those things were discussed. For instance, we will no longer have openable windows. That's one of those things that apparently was cheaper. We'll have windows, but they won't be openable. Well, I think that that's kind of a crazy thing to do in this climate, especially when the district is moving the school year earlier in the summer and what have you. If air conditioning does go down or power goes down for some reason, to not be able to open those windows. I know at the lower campus, even though it's obviously an older campus, they do have issues with the heating and the air conditioning there. I just think it's huge to be able to have those openable windows. Another thing that I know that was mentioned for sure that was cut was the permeable surfaces. If anybody's ever been over on that campus in a rainstorm this year or last year, it floods at the lower quadrant every time. Kids have to jump over puddles and barricades, or if you're my son, you go right through it. I think in this day and age with environmental concerns and everything, things like that seem like an easy thing to take out, but shouldn't we be really considering the site and the environment and our children's future? Isn't that why we're educating them and sending them to good schools, is so that they can have an environment to grow up into? There was one other thing that I remember that was pulled, but those are just the things months and months ago that I know were pulled from the project. I can't imagine taking millions out now, what other things are being pulled. Oh, the air conditioning.
About 30 seconds.
It was going from, we will have air conditioning, I understand, but instead of being environmentally friendly, it's going to be your standard air conditioning. And although the input costs are cheaper, the cost of running it for the district is higher. So things like that, it looks easy to make that change now, but then you're costing the district more money for in perpetuity. So just those kind of things worry me. I'd like to know specifically what those engineering things are that are going away or changing. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Mr. Brady.
Good evening, Council. My name is Tom Brady, South Cannon resident, former president of the Rotary Club of Sierra Madre 2011-2012, active parent in the community. I think what we're witnessing tonight is the a showdown of accountability interests. As taxpayers, we are all bound to meet our obligations in the tax bills, which have been paid. And I would ask your consideration to honor the obligation that the PUSD has created in terms of an obligation to the community and parents of Sierra Madre. You see, you've created an expectation and sold us a bill of goods. Now we're just waiting for delivery. We're not going to wait for the Pony Express. We're not going to wait for Federal Express. We need this to happen now, and I think we'd all agree that we all have the right intentions and the talent and the resources to get the project done. We heard from Gretchen Vance about the TT oversight and the responsibility and checkpoints that would make this happen. Rotary Club served 2 years in portables, and we saw the commitment that you spoke about earlier with regard to the teachers and the sacrifices that the community has already made. So I think we would all agree that with your leadership, let's fulfill the obligation you created with the passage of the TT funding and honor the public trust. Thank you.
Good evening, Sandra Saraganian, 61 Park. Just a point of clarification, Scott Phelps, I think you said that you're anticipating a vacancy on the board. And I'm assuming that that's not due to the election that's going to be coming up here real soon. So I'm hoping that maybe you can answer that for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Saraganian. Any other members of the public care to speak before we bring this back and answer some of the questions that have been raised tonight? Seeing none, I'm going to bring this back to the board and to council. And we do have a series of questions, a lot of which I think that Superintendent Gundry can answer. But
Any board members can feel free to jump in, and I'm just going to go in the same order that they were given. We did have a question regarding the investigation of Oscar Aga and Brown. Do we have an update on that?
I last spoke with the investigator probably about 2 weeks ago on this issue, and we're still waiting for a final investigation report. So it's impossible really to say what that's going to look like when it comes back in. But I'm a little confused by the references of taking money, because I don't even know that that's been alleged. But there's some questions about reporting of time and some oversight of the department. But we're still waiting for a final investigative report, which I believe it should be due in the next couple of weeks. Because the last time we got an update, they said it would be, 2 to 4 weeks? Is that what they said? 3 weeks? And so it's been nearly that long now. So we should be able to give a final report. It'll have to go to the board first and see if there's any action warranted on the part of the board. And then whatever decision is made will be made public at that time. So it shouldn't be much longer before we have some definitive information on that topic.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Brandenburg, we went through this at the last meeting.
I'm sorry,
public comment
is still open.
Public comment is not open. I did close public comment, and we brought it back to council and the board. Can you please take a seat? The other question that we had involved, there were several questions that involved, the scaling down to 20%. There were a lot of statements made that the across-the-board scaling down across the entire school district doesn't really ring true with the idea that this is the number one construction priority. Can we get some comments on that?
I might defer that to members of the Facilities Committee, but I believe that in the case of the Sierra Madre project, it was not scaled down 20%. Is that because when the classroom building was added back into the project, I believe that it was not taken down 20%. So I think that this is probably a project, one of the few projects that was not scaled back to that extent. But a member of the Facilities Committee might be able to speak more specifically to that because I wasn't at that meeting.
I can speak to that. That's accurate. The initial facility master plan revision recommendation from the architectural firm was to eliminate 4 classrooms from Sierra Madre Middle School. That was getting in line with the budget based on the 20%. But the decision was made to build the additional 4 classrooms. So. I don't have the exact dollar figures of that portion, off the top of my head, but that clearly was basically showing that we were funding it at a level different than a flat 20% reduction. I think the other thing, just to put it in context, the original 2008 facility master plan made assumptions of state matching funds based on what the state was matching in terms of funding at that time. That was in 2008, before the economy crashed, before all kinds of things happened, and the state was basically going bankrupt and decided not to do a facility bond, which was the source of the matching funds for additional augmentation of local bonds. So the first projects out the gate were still based on the largest number that was the original facility master plan, which included the additional $64 million in projected state matching funds. That's why Blair, was the first project out. It was built. It was not, I know there was some, one of the members of the public spoke to projects that were massively over budget. I think Blair was over budget by 80,000, something like that. I mean, that's a very small percentage of, maybe it was a $13 million budget. So there are no projects massively over budget. But keep in mind, as you start to scale back and take $64 million out of the projects, and which is a roughly this 20% figure, some of them, you can't undo. Blair is built. Some of the projects are underway. They're already in construction. So it's not a flat across the board. And as the facility master or the facilities committee sort of worked through that, combing through the recommendations, we were trying to sort of pull it back into what are the programmatic needs, what are the priorities in terms of the district. So there's some things that could be defunded. We don't want to just go through and lop off, you know, let's take this building out because that's about 20%. So, you know, we're continuing to do that refinement. It's not as simplistic as that, but the biggest, broadest brushstroke of it is we reduce 20% out of the whole facility master plan. So I
think that the distinction might be made is we're keeping the school at capacity. You didn't reduce that type of that by 20%, but we are looking at a dollar amount of, you know, a project that was on books at $32 million. And I think there were some questions about all of the numbers, and as they've scaled down to $22.5 million, you know, how do we get to that number? And then we've got we've got the CFO saying that $26 million is about what they plan on these bids coming in at, and are we going to go through with that? And then I guess the last question that kind of dovetails into all of that is, what are the value adds that are going to be stripped from the school? And there was some mentioning of not using as efficient air conditioning system, that we're replacing some semi-permeable surfaces with impermeable surfaces, and what actual effects are we going to be seeing?
Mr. Mayor, I just want, for the record, all school site budgets were reduced across the board by 20%.
Yeah.
I was in the facility subcommittee. We didn't reduce McKinley. We reinvested about $1.2 million back at the Washington Complex. So there was allowances. So that's the fact. We made allowances given we look at the historical distribution of funds of our school sites. So I would just say keep that in mind as we Sierra Madre makes the argument for the necessary funds for Sierra Madre Middle School.
But let's actually talk those numbers if we can, and then we'll come back to that, because I do agree with that. And I think that one of the things that all these people in the room and some of the people watching at home and the people who couldn't be here are concerned with is, you know, we have the chance to build a flagship middle school for PUSD, and to keep matriculation going up into the, you know, from elementary to middle, and then from middle to high school, and that's where we're seeing a lot of the kids peeling off and going to private schools, and you know, as a lot of the parents have mentioned, that's one of the big concerns. And if we have if we don't scale back too much, and we do build a state of the art middle school in Sierra Madre, and we do see, you know, this school that everybody wants to go to, and we might see that continue on as those kids go on and into PHS and continue bringing that kind of level of education and experience into that school. So
I would just add, I mean, because this was another question that came up, and it's sort of to the point you're making, the district has seen an overall enrollment decline, which is actually something that's happened in school districts across the state. Glendale has had a significant, you know, decline in enrollment. I mean, there's housing pattern issues, costs of rentals, demographics around birth rates. There's a whole set of things that go into all of these kinds of numbers and movement and such, which certainly adds to the complexity of planning for any public agency. But the area of growth, and we looked at this in the Davis demographics projections, the part of the district that's growing is East Pasadena and Sierra Madre. That's why it made sense to have the capacity, the middle school, at the capacity that it was built to, not just to replace it with what was existing. So that is true. There is, but overall, there is still an overall enrollment decline, and that has a lot of impacts both on the operating budget and then on the facility side as well.
Okay. Dr. Pappalardo, is there any way we can speed this process up?
Can I add just one thing, though? I mean, the questions you're asking and the clear frustrations of the parents speak to the need to have more and better communication as all of these things are in flux and in motion. And it seems to me that just the fact that we're sitting here without a set of plans to at least, now I understand that there, you know, some of this is in the works. There's two, you know, consultants working that have to meld together recommendations. And so they can't show you an exact picture of what's going to be built because some of this is still in the works. But it just, I think we feed people's perception that maybe this will never happen, or that I don't know what they're promising, or I saw something and now it's changed. If we have ineffective, incomplete communication, and it's pretty hard to over-communicate, so I just think we need to have a whole lot more going, both directly to your council, so that you, because, you know, you're in touch with whole lots of people in the community, but also to the school site council. I know some of that is going on, but I think this whole process and the comments just clearly state a whole lot about the lack of communication around the process on an ongoing basis, so people at least are aware of what's happening. And, you know, I mean, certainly when we have things like this facility scandal, you know, the chief of facilities on, you know, paid administrative leave, people start supposing all kinds of things. We just want to try and get all the facts out and communicate as effectively as possible.
Excellent, excellent point. Dr. Pomerel?
I think you might consider scheduling a monthly update at your council meetings, and someone from the district would come. I don't know who I'm volunteering at this point, but I think it certainly would keep you posted to have a kind of emissary from PUSD come on a monthly basis.
That would be most welcome, and not only that, especially over the next 6-8 months when all of this is going on. Councilmember Capocha, you.
I think Dr. Pomeroy is suggesting that maybe somebody from the school board give us an update.
Or staff.
Yeah, or staff. Okay.
Okay.
Mr. Thompson, being the project manager, he would have the details. I'd appreciate hearing from him.
Okay. Excellent.
Great.
We had a couple questions about whether or not we'd be able to allocate more resources and speed this process up. Is that?
I don't believe that point would have been on awarding the $29 million bid, and so we're beyond that. So I don't think additional resources will speed it up at this point. We certainly are going at this as quickly as possible, and the people who are working on it are here listening to it, including the architect. So we're moving on that with all due haste. Let me give you a quick update on the budget numbers and how it works. The $22.5 million was sort of the base construction projection, but then there's another 10% on top of that for change order contingencies, plus some other escalation factors that brought the total amount up to about $25.6 million. And then if you do soft costs at 20% of that, that's an additional $5 million. And we talked about soft costs being architect fees and project management and inspector of records and all of those. So we're at just around the $30 million range for this construction. The last $1.5 million or so was the current, the demolition and the interim housing. So that sort of rounds out the $32.1 million that we're talking about.
Dr. Papalardo, the 20 months, I mean, I know we're not there.
Yeah,
yet,
that's enough.
I think that's what people are asking.
That was an
awful. Can that 20 months be speeded up?
That's an awfully good question. And what would the difference between, say, 20 months and 19 months be?
Enough of a difference. I'm thinking more like 15.
Well, I will tell you, the shorter the timeline, the more expensive it is. So, you know, you could say 12 months, but the cost of that would be pretty high.
Like it when it comes back to us once the award is made. I'd like to see those differences, though.
There's no way to actually.
You can't even
know those. Let's think about this out loud. Could you do two bids, or could you do an ad alternate and say, what would it be if we did it in 15 months? I would venture to say nobody's done that before.
I think one of the things we learned actually from this past bid is that we had.
Do you mind? Yeah, or at least grabbing the microphone from Superintendent Gundry. We are televised, and
One of the things I think that we're learning from the last bid process is that we had this project. Has a couple of phases to it. The first phase is the construction of all the buildings themselves, and the time period that was given to the contractors was shortened like 15 or 16 months. And from the investigation that we're doing, actually by talking to some of those contractors, that added some cost to the project. We don't know they don't always disclose all the specifics of their values, but it did make a difference. And so you have to find the right time period for a project size. If it's too short, it costs more money, and if it's too long, it costs more money. So you have to find about the right timeline, and we think that phase one part should be about 18 months to get the best bid value.
Okay. Thank you very much. There were some questions regarding Measure Y monies and whether or not Sierra Madre saw any of those.
I can speak to that, having been on the board for 12 years. I think it was stated that Sierra Madre never got any Measure Y work. To clarify that, there are two campuses. There's the lower school and the upper school, where the middle school is going to be built. The upper school at the time was occupied by Maranatha. I think you may recall that in this community. Mm-hmm. And so there was no Measure Y dollars allocated to a site that was not occupied by PUSD students. Hence, actually, the reason why Sierra Madre now is the biggest project in the whole district, because it wasn't modernized as part of Measure Y, because it wasn't actually occupied at the time. Now, the lower school, the elementary school, did get entire new buildings, got a major modernization. Some of the parents that were, you know, there before and after can attest to the significant improvements that were made at Sierra Madre lower school. Again, we have a similar situation with the other biggest project in the district is McKinley, which likewise was not occupied under Measure Y. It was a building that wasn't open at the time. And so now that's a building that hasn't had modernization since it was built in the 30s or 20s. So that's also one of the very big ticket items in the whole master plan budget. So. But clearly, the elementary school got a lot of upgrades out of the original Measure Y budget.
Okay. And the last of the questions that I had on here, and I think it's just a more of a clarification. Board Member Phelps,
yeah,
please.
So, Sandy, I was guessing on the outcome of one of the races, and my colleague is currently in two years into her term, and. She's running in the election that's being held in her where she lives. So if she's victorious, she would resign an at-large seat and occupy the seat that she wins. So that would leave us with six. I don't know if that made sense. Okay. She gave me a thumbs up in the back there.
Makes perfect sense. And there was one more question. Well, there were probably a couple because I wrote down as many as I could. The other question was opening up the bidding process. The decision to do that, and obviously some assurances that whomever you pick will be thoroughly vetted. Obviously, to the question itself, give an answer as to why you opened up the bidding process to non-pre-qualified firms and your decision on that, and then what steps you'll take to assure that the firm that is finally chosen is thoroughly capable of performing this job.
Right. So the question is on pre-qualification. So the district some months ago went through, and districts are allowed to actually pre-qualified bidders, and they can ask a lot of questions, set some criteria, and as long as you meet those criteria, get the evaluations on it, they're put on a pre-qualified bidder list. We currently have 8 contractors on the pre-qualified bidder list. We've done now 2 bids to those 8 contractors, Sierra Madre Middle being the very first one, 6 of the 8 bid, and the second one was opened this past Friday, 5 of the 8 bid. The prices are coming in, as we see, higher than we're anticipating. So there's a sense now that it's an expensive group. So many districts bid many projects throughout the state, billions of dollars, without having a pre-qualified bidder pool. That doesn't mean that they're not qualified. So a bidder for a project must be able to post their bond, and in this case we're looking at, you know, $20 to $25 million in bonds. You can request within the bids that you've had, you know, X number of similar types of projects, similar size and scope, and all of those items that you put on a pre-qualified bidder, you can put within the bid, and then you have the lowest responsive bidder, and you go from there. So the idea is opening it up will give us a larger pool. There's many more than 8 contractors out there in the state of California, and possibly out of state too, that could bid on these. There's a concern when you have a pre-qualified pool of say 8 contractors that there could be that you'll see higher bids and a closer, tighter knit bidding process. And that what you're really missing on the savings is those contractors that maybe were $15 to $20 million contractors that are looking for now the $25 million contracts. Those bidders that have an opening in their schedule, because contractors like many, you know, may be really busy. And so if they're really busy, they're going to bid a higher number and say, if I can make a 30% profit, I'll take this job. Or a contractor that has a hole in their schedule that sees their projects coming to a close in the spring, that will now bid this project at, say, a 5 to 10% margin instead of a 20 to 40% margin. So we're of the opinion now that opening it up will still have good qualified bidders, we'll have the specs laid out, and we are looking for a more competitive price. That's the answer to that one.
Thank you.
I was just going to add, because the speaker mentioned, does this mean that there would be people who we wouldn't, they might get the low bid and then we'd find out they weren't bonded or insured, or, and the answer is no. I mean, to even begin a public bidding process, you have to have certain criteria. So all of the, anybody that went through it would have at least those kind of basic qualifications, or we wouldn't accept them.
Right. And what we find is when we open the bids, there's a whole series of boxes to check, and whether they have all of the bid information and the qualifications, the bonds, the paperwork in. And then the bidder actually has 5 days after they're open and told they're the low bidder to come back, and if they made a mistake in the bid, they can actually, through a process, withdraw their bid. So there's work going on, and if you have one withdrawal, then you go to the next one, and they have 5 days then to go back and forth. So there is, you know, a week or two process there after the bids are open to get to the final one. Sometimes the low bidder is happy, they're in, bid can be awarded at the next board meeting after that, and then start a couple weeks after that once all the paperwork's in and notice of proceeds and ready to go. So,
thank you. I think I got most of the questions, and please forgive me if I missed any of the questions that were out there. We've got other council members who may have picked up on those. Do we have any other questions for any members of the staff or the board before we move on to the final discussion item? And I'll preface that in just a moment. Councilmember Kerber.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to make a comment, and regarding the lack of communication, I appreciate the intent. I'm more of a results guy, and I got to tell you, these folks here and the folks at home, if you guys start putting shovels in the ground and start putting a frame up, they won't be worrying about communication, because the best communication is action. And what we hear a lot of, unfortunately, from PUSD in the last few years has been a lot of talk and no action. So if we're seeing movement and we're seeing dirt and we're seeing, you know, sticks being put up, that's a good day. Okay, so I would really emphasize, in my opinion and for the people that I've talked to, is that they want to see a building built. They don't want to be talked to some more. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Any members of the board, before we kind of close these two discussion items and move to the last one, any members of the board care to speak to the construction and situation of the bond, TT monies? All right.
Renata.
I'll just say that I apologize again. Your distrust of our process and our intent to build this is well deserved, and we just have to show you that we really are going to do it. And I don't think there's a whole lot that I can say that will make a difference, but just that we deserve everything you gave us tonight, and we hear you.
Thank you, Renata. The last item was parking concerns at PUSD, especially at the lower campus, and we're probably going to have some people exiting, but we do have some people who want to speak to that issue. And quite honestly, we are going to be having a different meeting with the residents and the school principal. But we thought we might ask a couple of questions. One is because we do have some residents who are very adjacent to Sierra Madre Elementary, where we've had a lot of issues, not only with the teachers not being able to park on their parking lot, but also just more and more parents dropping their kids off at school, and we're having a lot of issues with lack of supervision of any pickup drop off, and the neighbors are being adversely affected because of that. One of the things that I want to make sure that for those neighbors who are here is that we reiterate kind of the timeline for the removal of the transportables and when that parking lot's going to be reopened, so that there's some assurances there. And then to open it up to the board members and anybody or staff members of any ideas of what, obviously all of these schools are in residential neighborhoods, and we've got neighbors from around who are affected by what goes on at the school. Are there any other game plans, some ideas, some things that have been effective on other campuses? But if we can start at least with the rundown of the time frame, so that the neighbors who are here tonight or who are watching can once again be assured that at least there is a light at the end of that tunnel. And we'll turn it over to Fraser Thompson again.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Again, good evening. The projected completion date for construction at the Sierra Madre Elementary campus is March 21st. By the end of May, without giving you too many details in between, we expect to have the parking lot completely restored. I had mentioned when I spoke with you previously that I'm currently in the process of getting pricing to remove the 7 modulars that are on the Sierra Madre Elementary campus. I will have to work with the police department and also Director Inman to coordinate that removal. It's going to be a challenge because we have power lines along the street. We're going to need to take those units out by crane, and they're wide loads, which are restricted travel times on the streets and the freeways. I expect to move on the removal of those modulars as soon as the students and teachers are relocated into the new building. When exactly that occurs is strictly up to the principal and school administration. But again, by the end of May, it's my goal to have the parking lot completely restored.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson.
Thank you.
Any questions from councilmen we've already gone through that. I guess the question is to the board members and to staff. I mean, what do we do with a correct integration of school and residents, and how do we manage some of the picking up and dropping off of students and being conscientious of the neighbors who are actually living there, some of whom work from home and such, and blocking of driveways and things of that nature. I'm sure you've probably dealt with this at other schools, and what kind of model can we be looking at? Board Member Phelps, you.
Well, I've been at two schools, Cleveland and McKinley. McKinley seems to have it down a lot better. There's people that keep it moving, right, sort of through kind of maybe you call it a valet, but I don't know if that's the right word. It's an area with cones, and a person. Now that site's a little different. The city actually pays for a crossing guard there at McKinley, so there's a little different situation there in terms of safety. But I would be interested, and I'm sure that the principal and our administration is interested as well as you in making this work, because we always are. And so, I mean, we have had this issue at many sites, normal issues, so I believe we can solve it. Oh, there we go.
There we go.
Just talk long enough.
Good evening. Thank you. My name is Esther Salinas, and I am the proud principal of Sierra Madre Elementary School. And one of the important things that we want to teach all of our students is good citizenship. So we have to take the lead in that. And so I want to extend my apology to the neighbors surrounding the school for if trash cans are moved and people are blocking driveways. We do make continual reminders of courtesy that they are mindful of parking and blocking ways. We do want to be respectful, and we do know that we need your partnership and support, and are so appreciative of that. We do send out a Sunday evening call on a weekly basis, and regularly remind our community members to be mindful of your driveways, and so that we are good neighbors. We also have put things in the newsletters and want to, and will continue to do so.
Thank you, Principal Salinas. Mm-hmm. Any questions from council of staff or board regarding this before we open it up to the public? Councilmember Capocha.
Yeah, regarding the number of parking sites for the school, I don't know who to direct this question to, but what is the proper number for a population that you have? Because part of the problem is that there's people parking on the street all day. Right now we understand a lot of them are teachers, but I'm concerned that maybe there isn't enough parking for everybody that might be at the school, volunteers, parents, everybody else. Because it really is affecting the neighbors near the school. So who can answer that?
I'm not prepared with a precise answer for that, but I think that once the parking lot's restored, I think you'll be pretty close to what you would typically see at an elementary school for parking. And I think the biggest traffic issue comes when you have pickup and drop off. So, and there's a limited amount that you can do on site with pickup and drop off. It just takes a lot of real estate, a lot of asphalt to do that. So I think we've got close to enough parking there, but I don't have the exact numbers, what requirements are. It varies from city to city, and there actually are no standards that necessarily govern public schools. But this is fairly typical what I've seen at a lot of other elementary schools of similar size.
You know, one of the problems is on Highland, right in front of the school, the curb is painted white because that's the pickup and drop off area. That curb was not painted white before the school was rebuilt. The school was closed for a couple years. I don't know how long ago that was now. But so there was another place that kids were being picked up and dropped off. I don't know if that was in the parking lot, but since that time, the traffic on Highland has gotten markedly worse. That is just not a good place to pick up and drop off because that part of the street is very narrow. Now, on the Auburn side, too, the whole curb is painted red because that was where busing, back in the day when we did have busing, all the buses would line up there. And I know this because I live two houses from it. So I've lived through this. That red curb is not needed anymore. I know that buses come every now and then, but not the entire length of that block practically. So who is going to look into this to optimize not only the parking, but the pickup and drop off?
Well, perhaps we can, the staff of PUSD, and we can work with the city, the police department, and public works to see if we can maybe get some suggestions for that. I mean, that is city property and it's city jurisdiction on how the curbs are striped and painted, so we can probably work with them and see if there's a possible change there or a necessity for what was done in the past.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that, but let me just say that, I could be wrong. Maybe Madam City Manager can answer that, but I don't think the city would have painted that curb white on their own when that school reopened. You know, I mean, that's just beyond my comprehension that they would just decide now that that curb needed to be painted white. I'm guessing that somebody in the school either asked for it or initiated it. So I'd like to hear the answer to that.
I don't know if Director, I'm not sure when that curb was painted white. I don't know if Director Inman remembers. But we do work.
He does.
He does remember.
Good evening, Council and board members. Yes, the district or representatives from the school itself did ask for the curbs to be painted to facilitate their parking and drop-off issues, both on the Auburn side for the buses and on the Highland side.
I would like to just add that I have personally spoken with the principal about the red curb on Auburn. She has informed me there still are a few buses that still come there, but not the number that
we used to have.
And she was going to meet with the transportation staff at PUSD and try to get that red curb minimized as much as we can and open up some of it for parking.
Good to know. Dr. Pomeroy had something to say.
As the chair of the safety committee of the board, I know that our staff has been looking at the safe arrival of students and looking for interesting and valuable comparisons to make. And although I don't remember exactly the configuration of your elementary school, I can tell you that is the open space. I can tell you what is being done at Jackson Elementary, where they have an area of pavement on one of the side streets. Jackson is on a very busy street, Woodbury. So what they've done is to paint a curving route into the paved area and then out again. And at the time of arrival and of pickup, they put cones out there, and the parents drive right in and safely drop off their students. Then when that process is finished, it becomes the playground again. So it's worked well there in that school, which is on a busy street. So there are some interesting comparisons that could be made.
Definitely something to look at, although yeah, where the playground is isn't conducive to that, but the other side, the Auburn side, might be. I think it's incumbent upon us and the city staff as well as Sierra Madre Elementary School staff to really come up with some good ideas, and we will be meeting with the residents. But I will at this point open up the podium to for public comment on this item, which is parking concerns at the campus. If there's any member of the public in the audience who would care to speak to that, please feel free to come to the podium and keep your comments to about 3 minutes, please.
Hi, members of the board and the city council. My name is Vince DeMarzo. I live across the street from the school. I'm not going to sit there and deliver a lot of heat to you because I think you've taken enough heat tonight from the residents. But before coming here tonight, I drove by three of the schools. Pasadena operates Jefferson, Norma Coombs, and Don Benito. I counted 50 spaces on-site at Jefferson, approximately five handicap spaces within a confined paved area and an area within drop-off. And within the Jefferson, there's a District A that Pasadena created for residential parking only, no teacher parking, no drop-off parking. Norma Coombs has approximately 37 spaces, two handicap spaces, and also on-site drop-off. Don Benito has a circular driveway off of Sierra Madre Boulevard with at least 40 spaces, 20 of which were coned off to facilitate drop-off of students. And then if you drive in the driveway for the church, there's another approximately 20 spaces and some handicap spaces. So looking at the Sierra Madre parking lot, which has been subject to, obviously, by the trailer use right now, that school originally was not as large as it is now due to the remodel. There are more teachers, there's more staff, there's more volunteers. The parking's woefully inadequate. At one point, there was a design, a turnabout, which is adjacent to the, looks like like a flat area that's paved where you have your job trailers now. That would have been the perfect place. In fact, it was mentioned that was going to be the turnout, but then they paved it over and put some compass. It would be in your best interest to get the kids off the street, because I see a lot of kids jaywalking. I live, sometimes I work for the state and I get furloughed a lot. And so on Friday mornings, I'll drink coffee, look out the window and cringe as people drop their kids off, block the driveway and dart out across the street. And one of these days, somebody's gonna get hit. A lot of the parents have to park a block and a half away. They block the driveways, they lift up the trash cans. I'm not gonna get into all that garbage as the mayor mentioned. But the facility is inadequate for staff parking. I think that either the city has to create a special parking zone like Pasadena does, because Pasadena obviously has issues with all of its schools, Polytechnic, Caltech. So either the school board comes up with something for the district to create, or the city can have the option to create a special residential parking zone. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeMarco. Any other members of the public care to speak to this issue?
Good evening. My name is Elizabeth Romo. I live on Victoria Lane, which is adjacent to the school, and I appreciate what the principal has done as far as putting in the newsletter and the phone calls. But somebody isn't getting the message, because I had somebody in my driveway Friday for at least 5 minutes talking in the morning. And I really think it's a safety issue to have the children dropped off in the driveway, double parked. My street's very narrow. I live close to Auburn, where the crosswalk is. And you know, I really think that's a safety issue. And I only have parking on my side, which is the south side. And I have that all day from 7 to 4. My concern is that what Vince said was the parking won't be adequate. I'm also concerned, you know, it's my street is very popular because it can, staff can park and cross, and they're right there by the classrooms, and it's popular for volunteers, I'm sure, and parents. So I don't know if that's, you know, it's too tempting to park there. It's too close. Hermosa, too. The classrooms are right across the street. Why would you park over here when you can just park on Hermosa? So I think that's going to be, you know, an issue that's going to have, some planning's going to have to go into that. Let's see. But the safety issue, I think, is very important. And then the inconvenience. You know, if I need to have service people come, I have to put the trash cans out to block off the parking. And I guess that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public here to speak to this issue? All right, I'm going to bring it back to council and the board. Any further comments? This is something that we will take seriously, and it's something that we need to look at as a joint venture between the school and the city, and what we can all do to make it easier and better on the residents. And I do appreciate all of the emails and the email chains and the thought that were put into those emails, and I think that we've got some good ideas to start with, and I think that getting together and having an actual meeting with the community members who are affected and the staff at the school and city staff, I think we can get some of these things accomplished.
Mr. Mayor, just one That's quick question. I assume that we're using the parking lot at the old rec center on 186 Highland. Is that being used as a parking lot for the school?
Overflow,
so,
yeah.
Yeah. So I was going to say, if that's not, I mean, that's one temporary solution, but already full.
Yeah. I was just going to add, I mean, this is really typical, because most schools that were built, particularly in the 20s, and, you know, people walked to school. They had one car. They didn't drive, you know, four blocks to get somewhere. And so, I mean, we have this all over the place at many, many schools, and they're, you know, the parking is subpar. Yes. But I mean, I would just encourage you to consider some traffic enforcement, and people get the message pretty clearly when they may get a ticket, or at least if the principal is telling them on the phone that you may get a ticket and their city is looking at this because, you know, this is inconveniencing the residents, and do not park in a driveway. Do not. I mean, the other thing is to consider, and again, this may be a cost that might not work, but a traffic study that would, you know, or a traffic engineer, or maybe the city of Pasadena might even loan you one of their traffic, you know, engineers to do a quick study of, are there some things that could be done? You know, you can restrict parking at particular types of the day. You can do sticker parking. We've looked at one-way streets, you know, turning a street even into a one-way street to address parking issues. So there's possible things, but they also have their downside because people don't like to have a one-way street when they just had the access both directions. So it might be worth reaching out to Pasadena to see if there's some possibility where they could assist with some recommendations at no cost.
Not bad. And it would also be helpful if we heard some of the other, remedies that other schools have done, especially schools in different areas and with different problems, because we've got an interesting location there. Any other members of the board care to speak?
It certainly was the case at my kids' first school at Cleveland when we had to cut out of the plan the all the loop, the drive in and drop off. So that was Cleveland's cut from its plan and some other things. Very narrow street north of the school. So the city immediately, their reaction was to put up no parking all along there and start putting those tickets in.
Yeah. Okay. Good to know. Excellent.
City revenue.
We get such a little percentage of those things, though.
I'm thinking we might not want to go there. I'm just guessing.
Hey, on behalf of the city council and the city, I'd like to thank everybody from the board for coming in tonight and listening to what our residents have to say. I'd like to thank the superintendent, I'd like to the CFO, I'd like to thank the site coordinator, I'd like to thank the architect. Thank you all very much, and the principal of Sierra Madre Elementary. Thank you for coming in this evening and listening to what our residents have to say. As you can tell, we're a small community, but we're a very vocal and passionate community, and we'd like to see these things move forward. And with that, I would like to entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
And motion passes.